Welcome to my Dreams Academy.
Hello, good friends. I'm by name Festus Kings. We are live here at my Dreams Academy online studio, and we believe you are going to learn a lot from today's class. Please, before I forget, make sure you subscribe to this channel and even share this video to your friends. Now, for the purpose of our lectures today, I'm going to limit whatever I'm going to teach today to dumb bites, students preparing for post-UTME, schools of nursing exams in Nigeria, and even WAEC and local candidates. Today we'll be talking about endocrine system, as you can see. But before we proceed, I think it's right we'll get to know what we are going to see in this endocrine system we'll be talking about. Now, before we talk about endocrine system, you know, there's need to maintain homeostasis. I say that endocrine system works synchronously with the nervous system and other glands in maintenance of homeostasis. And what is homeostasis? We said that homeostasis is the regulation of the internal environment of the body. Now, as human beings, we need to regulate our internal environment. We need to adjust it in a way such that we are acclimatized to our environment. And we have basically some organs that helps us in achieving this homeostatic mechanism. We have number one, the endocrine system. We have the nervous system. We have the kidney and the skin. Now, these are the things that helps us to what? Regulate our internal environment. But for the purpose of this lecture, we'll be concentrating on the work of the endocrine system as a homeostatic system. Now, I define endocrine system. You can write, start writing. Endocrine system, it consists of group of glands and capillaries which facilitate the diffusion of hormone into the bloodstream. Have you gotten that? It consists of glands and the group of capillaries which facilitate the diffusion of hormone into the bloodstream. So I have a word here, hormone. And I have another word here, bloodstream. Okay, now we are going to study these words. Now, we need to know what is a gland. You can write, a gland is a specialized organ which secretes a particular chemical substance into the body or into the surrounding. Is a group of organ or is an organ which secretes a particular chemical substance into the body or its surrounding. Basically, at this level, we have three types. At this level, take note, we have three types of glands in the body. We have the endocrine, we have the exocrine, and we have the heterocrine. Okay, you can see it on the board. Let's start with the endocrine. We've defined endocrine as a gland and group of capillaries that secretes hormone, a chemical substance known as hormone, into the world bloodstream, and we call endocrine gland a ductless gland. Mark the word ductless. Ductless. In that the products of endocrine glands are being secreted into the bloodstream. That means they diffuse into the blood, and the blood serves as a transport system. The blood carries this chemical substance, which we call hormone, to a target organ where it exerts a function. So this small quantity of hormones, this small quantity of chemical substances, actually diffuse into the blood. unlike the exocrine. The exocrine produces their products and pour them into ducts. Take note, their products are being poured into ducts. Example of exocrine, we have the sweat gland. We have the lacrimal gland. We have the mammary gland. We have the stomach, etc. Now you see, for the sweat, when I look for the sweat or saliva, I cannot go, okay, I don't write the salivary gland, the salivary what? Gland. I cannot look for the saliva into the blood. I cannot start checking whether my blood contains saliva. The saliva is poured into the what? It's being produced at the salivary duct. It has a duct. Do you understand? And you know, the salivary gland is one of the accessory organ of digestion. So all these ones, you can actually find them in their ducts. Their contents are not found in the blood. Their contents are not being secreted into the blood. Unlike the endocrine system, we say that their contents actually diffuse into the blood, and the blood serves as a transport system conveying this chemical substance to a place, to a destination where it will exercise, or where it will exhibit a particular function. Take note. Now, we are going to look at another one we call the heterocrine. The heterocrine. Now, the heterocrine actually combines the function of endocrine and exocrine. And at your level, Jambias, at your level, the one we know now at your level, because when you enter the university, they start telling you other ones, and they are still heterocrine. But for JAMB's sake, and for schools of nursing's sake, and for WAEC and NECO's sake, we choose what? Pancreas. So the pancreas has a dual function. It has an exocrine function, and it also has an endocrine function. We are not going to explore that now. When we come to that aspect, when we reach at the pancreas, we are going to explore the endocrine function of the pancreas and the exocrine function of the what? Pancreas. Now let's study another keyword here, hormone. The word hormone is actually gotten from a Greek word. Hormone is actually gotten from a Greek word. Now, and what does it mean? It means to force or to what? Impel. To force or impel. Now, hormones are chemical messengers that are actually released into the bloodstream, and they are carried to their target organ, where they exert a function, as we have said earlier. Okay, now let's go ahead and classify hormones. So we're going to classify hormones. Remember, we have defined hormones as chemical messengers. So let's just have a classification of these hormones. Now, we classify hormones according to their chemical structure. Number one, according to chemical structure, right? Number two, according to their water and lipid solubility. According to chemical structure, we are going to classify hormone. Number one is amino acid derivatives. Amino acid derivatives. Now, the amino acid derivatives are being synthesized, or they are being gotten from the amino acid tyrosine. They are being gotten, right? They are being gotten from the amino acid tyrosine. Example includes, number one, catecholamines. Okay, example of catecholamines are adrenaline and noradrenaline. Let me write it for you. Adrenaline. But you can also call adrenaline epinephrine. And noradrenaline, which you can also call norepinephrine. Now take notes, Jam. or white students, it is called NOR, N-O-R, not none. So the adrenaline and noradrenaline are the emergency hormones for flight and fight. Now, the next we are going to talk about, which is also an amino acid derivative, are the what? The thyroid hormones. The thyroid hormones. And we know the thyroid hormones to be what? The T3 and the T4. T3, triiodothyronine. T4 is what? Tyrosine. Now, the next one we are going to look at are the protein and the peptide-based hormones. Protein and peptide-based hormones. Example of protein and peptide-based hormones are, okay, you can remember all the hormones that are produced in the pituitary, both anterior and posterior pituitary. They are what? Protein and peptide-based what? Hormones. And also what? You have your insulin and the hormones produced in the pancreas as an example of what? Protein and peptide-based hormones. Another classification we are going to look at is classification based on lipid and water solubility, right? Classification based on lipid and water solubility. In this classification, we have the what? The lipid hormones and the thyroid hormones, they belong to the lipid soluble hormones. The steroid hormones and the thyroid hormones belong to the what? Lipid soluble hormones. While catecholamines, and protein and peptide hormones belong to the water-soluble hormones. Okay, before we go ahead discussing the endocrine glands improper, I think it would be right if we differentiate between an endocrine control and the nervous control. Endocrine and nervous. Endocrine and nervous. You know, we've established this protocol that for us to achieve this homeostasis, we need these two systems to work hand in hand. But it is right we get it right here by differentiating between the activities. So when you see an endocrine function, when you see a nervous function, you can be able to say, okay, wow, this is an endocrine function. Wow, this is a nervous function. Okay, so let's see in endocrine system, we said that the message are chemically carried by the bloodstream. But in nervous, the message are electrically and chemically carried by the neuron. Take note. Now, another difference in endocrine, it has a widespread effect. It evokes a widespread effect since it has to be carried to the target organ. But in nervous system, they are localized. The effects generated by nervous system are mainly localized. Another difference here, in endocrine system, it produces a long lasting effect. The effects generated by endocrine system are long lasting, while those of the nervous system are relatively short-lived. They are relatively what? Short-lived. Okay, another difference here, the endocrine system evokes a slow response. The response by endocrine system are slower, while that of the nervous are faster. In endocrine system, it occurs in animals and plants, while that of nervous only occur in animals. So, we've seen the cardinal differences between these two systems. We said that the message in endocrine are carried by the bloodstream, while in nervous, they're electrically and chemically carried by the neuron. The endocrine system produces a widespread effect, you can write, while that of the nervous is localized. The endocrine system is long-lasting effect, nervous is short-lived. The endocrine system response are relatively slower, while that of the nervous system are faster, and endocrine response occurs in animals and plants, but nervous is mainly for what? Animals. Now, looking at these differences, I want to challenge you, my students, okay? Can you find out the similarity between this endocrine and nervous system? Can somebody just take a good look at what we've written? Can you see any similarity between these two systems? Okay, that's right. Let me help you. Now, the similarity we can see here is both uses chemical messengers. Take note. Because they will always ask you in your JAMB examination, in your post-UTME, and your schools of nursing entrance examination. The difference between endocrine and nervous system is dash. Now, take note. Both uses what? Chemical what? Messengers. Now, if you can remember that we said that endocrine uses chemical, which are carried by the bloodstream. But nervous uses electrical and also they use this chemical. But it is good we take note of this. Now, the nervous transmission uses mainly electrical. But when we were told about a synapse, what is a synapse, class? A synapse is a place where two neurons meet. And that place where they meet, there's a potential space that exists there, which is known as what? The synaptic cleft. Now, how can they communicate to each other? They need to release a chemical substance since they are not touching each other. Now, the chemical substance here is known as neurotransmitter. So, in nervous system, we use neurotransmitters. Now, when you people were taught about the cell signaling, can you remember? Cell signaling, they told you about the autocrine secretion, the paracrine secretion. You can check your notes, you have it there. You have the endocrine and the neurocrine. Now we see that the endocrine uses hormones as the chemical messenger, but in neurocrine, we use neurotransmitters. So, neurotransmitters are also chemical messengers. So, this gives us what we need, that the similarity between endocrine and nervous system control is that both uses chemical messenger known as hormone for endocrine and neurotransmitter for nervous. Okay, let's go ahead and list the endocrine organs as we have in the body. Cephalocuda, meaning from the head to the toe. Okay, now I'm going to list the major ones. The major endocrine organs or glands, and we are going to have the minor endocrine organ. Number one, we have the pineal gland. Number two, the pituitary. The thyroid gland. We have the parathyroid. You know what is para? Around. Okay. We have the adrenal gland. We have the pancreas. The pancreas, okay. And we have the gonads. The gonads are the testes for male and ovary for the female. The minor endocrine organs here, the minor, you just say just this much. Now we have the heart. You know, the heart has a secondary endocrine function, but when we reach there, we are going to tell you why the heart is an endocrine organ. We have the kidney, we have the liver, we have the stomach, we have the skeleton, etc. Now some, when we start discussing, we'll list them too, as we remember. Okay, let's start with the pituitary gland. Let's just start with that guy. He's the master gland. After the pituitary, we go back to the pineal gland. The pituitary gland is otherwise known as the master gland. Take notes, you can write. It is known as the master gland. Master gland. The pituitary gland, you can also call the pituitary gland the hypophysics. The hypophysics. It is also called the hypophysics. The pituitary gland has three basic divisions: the anterior pituitary, the anterior pituitary, the intermediate, and the posterior pituitary. The posterior, anterior, you know your anatomical positions, and you know what is anterior and posterior. Okay, now the anterior pituitary can also be called the adeno hypophysics. So just connect it, adeno hypophysics. While the posterior is known as the neurohypophysics. Okay, now let's look at the diagram here. You see the diagram of the pituitary gland. I need to show you the diagram so we explain everything about the pituitary gland. Now in the diagram you can see here, okay, as you can see, this is the diagram of the pituitary gland. We say that the pituitary gland is the master gland and it lies in the head region, particularly in the hypophyseal fossa of the sphenoid bone. Hypophyseal fossa, in bracket, cella tossica of the sphenoid bone. So the sphenoid bone is somewhere here. Now there is a fossa there. A fossa is a depression. Inside the fossa lies the pituitary gland, and the sphenoid bone is a bat-shaped bone. It's one of the cranial bones that is shaped like a bat. So in that depression in the sphenoid bone, we are going to see this pituitary gland. The pituitary gland weighs about 500 mg, and we said it has two or three basic divisions. This is the anterior pituitary, you can see it, otherwise known as the adenohypophysics. Watch the pointer. This is the posterior pituitary at the back, known as the neurohypophysics. You see, the pituitary gland is below the hypothalamus, and it is joined to the hypothalamus by an infundibulum or a pituitary stalk. See it here? It joins it. Now, you can see the paraventricular nucleus and the supraoptic nucleus in the hypothalamus. You can see them. is yellow here. So this is the pituitary gland. I repeat, this is the anterior. This is the posterior. This is a stalk that joins the pituitary to the hypothalamus. So we'll go ahead to see the hormones that are produced in this anterior pituitary and the hormones produced or stored in the posterior pituitary. Hormones of the anterior pituitary includes A, the growth hormone. Growth hormone, let's use GH to denote it. Growth hormone. Number two is the thyroid stimulating hormone. Hormone TSH. We have the adrenocorticotropic hormone, ACTH. We have the prolactin, PRL. We have the gonadotrophins. You know the gonadotrophins? They are the follicle stimulating hormone and the luteinizing hormone. Follicle stimulating hormone, FSH. Make sure you're writing. Make sure you're writing. And luteinizing hormone, LH. Okay? Are we missing anyone here? You can also have the melatonin stimulating hormone, MSH. Melatonin stimulating hormone. You see, we have growth hormone, thyroid stimulating hormone, adrenocorticotropic hormone, the prolactin, the gonadotrophins, which includes the FSH and the LH. We can also have melatonin stimulating hormone. Now let's move over to the hormones of the posterior pituitary. Now the hormones of the posterior pituitary are, now listen, I said hormones of. Actually, the posterior pituitary do not produce hormones. They actually stores the hormone I'm going to list now. And the hormones stored here are, right, antidiuretic hormone. I'll tell you what it means, ADH. You can also call this hormone vasopressin. Vasopressin, VASO, vasopressin, and oxytocin. Now remember, we said that these hormones are stored in the posterior pituitary. They are not produced here. Hormones of the posterior pituitary are actually produced at the hypothalamus. They are actually produced in the supraoptic and the paraventricular nucleus in the hypothalamus, as you've seen in the diagram we show you. So the hypothalamus actually produces them but stores them for use in the posterior pituitary. Now remember, we said the hypothalamus, when we listed the endocrine organ, be attentive, I'm addressing JAMB students and I'm addressing WAEC students. We are careful enough not to add the hypothalamus as one of the endocrine organ. But that does not mean that the hypothalamus is not an endocrine organ. But at your scope, is beyond your sea level. When you enter the university, they will tell you that the hypothalamus is an endocrine organ, and they are right. The hypothalamus is actually a neuroendocrine organ. The hypothalamus is a part of the brain, and it is also an endocrine organ. But listen, when you are writing your JAMB exam, be careful not to add them as a part of the endocrine system. Okay, just what we are saying in essence is that the hypothalamus produces the releasing and inhibiting hormones, together with ADH and oxytocin, but we still don't consider it at your level as
an endocrine organ.
These hormones listed here, we are going to know them, their function, and what they do in the body. We are going to review JAMB questions. We are going to review nursing questions as it pertains to this topic, but we have to stop here for now. In our next clip, we will do all these things we have listed, but let me tell you, I'm still Face to Skinks. I'm employing you, I'm charging you. Make sure you subscribe to our channel. Make sure you take this time to read. Don't just waste your time. Make sure you find time, start preparing for your post-UME. You nursing students, start preparing for your exam, because as soon as this break is over, you might have no time to do it. Thank you and God bless you.